伊今日要甲大家介绍的，就是讲 real war 哦 against America， 到底什么什么物件哈？啊，过来，这拢真紧都要跳过吼。迄、哦那个，这个规个 story 就是讲，到底伊是安怎哦 get into 这个这个 lawsuit 啊，互咱大家去 pay attention 哈、哦。这是 fly 有咱会馆啊，苏那个会尊给咱 produce 哈、哦、过来。OK， 伊伫十九岁时阵，大家个个报告就讲十九岁伊伫 Stanford 读大学个时阵，就已经创立一个公司，迄、那个公司叫做迄、那个啊，迄个 super region 哈、哦，就 fiber 迄、那个。fiber optic 的迄个公司吼，啊，就上市，确实真无简单。过来，伊伫这个2000年，其实伊 fight for this case actually is over 14 years， right？ Since 2002， 所以 actually 是已经14年吼，伊这个 lawsuit 的 case， 因为伊的智慧财产去用淘汰去吼，啊，伊的员工改淘汰。OK， 伊伫2003年的时阵，伊就赢这个 case， 啊，伊伫2009年，伊甲伊的这个 right 吼，甲背后其实是伊家己个创立一个公司的，叫做 B&M 啊 ，Kingston 这个公司，所以规个 case 就对 Florida 啊，刷去嘿 New York 吼、啊，后来就是2015年的时阵，就已经伫 New York State 的迄、那个啊。Supreme Court 已经判过伊赢哦，啊规定讲 Mega Bank 爱甲伊的资料摕出来，迄、那个 Mega Bank 爱甲资料，迄、那个相似物的资料摕出来，结果一直拢无进行吼、哦，所以伊这个 case 呢，就法院判决了时阵 ，actually you can do 这个 National Law Review， 这个是一个国家这个法律评鉴吼，真、哦、有名啊 ，very outstanding 吼、哦，过来就是这个。Consent order， 那是台湾 community 是安怎去 pay attention， 就是因为这个 consent order， 台湾地方发57亿代票，吼、哦，1.8亿的迄个美金，所以 shock to everyone， 吼、哦，今晚要大家介绍 how he loved his home country， 伊用偌济时间等于回馈伊的伊的本来的国家吼，伊、哦、以色列吼。哦这个就是他去捞罗棍的时阵了哈。为了要来咱家，伊坐 private jet 来咱家。哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈哈对，这个就是，那伊一旦跟咱 share， 不是跟咱讲这个 mega case， 伊是非常非常成功的一个房地产，吼、哦，就说伊也要跟讲 real estate 吼、哦，伊是 expert。OK。这礼拜一，伊 actually 伫 Washington DC 做一个 presentation， the Security 50来对，伊是一个 speaker 吼、哦。I'm sorry.当早起，伊伫有 Facebook， 甲 Facebook 嘅头家食饭吼，早餐吼，所以伊是 really like our community， 阿要甲咱 exchange 哈 information。OK， 啊，这就是伊要来以前伫菲律宾。OK。OK， 咱知影，这就是咱要。欢迎伊个迄个 keynote speaker 吼、哦， was you at this time we like to without any further ado, we like to welcome Mr. Kingston to
my professor. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. A little Mandarin, I know. Ni hao ma. Thank you very much for inviting me. I appreciate it. You have a very enthusiastic force in your community, John. Because I didn't know him from anything, and he called me and he brought me here, so thank you, John. Before we get started, I have a little present for John I want to present to you. John, this is from the one of the greatest commando organizations in the world, the Israeli Navy SEALs, which along with the United States Navy SEALs are probably the most trained experts at defending the freedom of the world. We've done missions that are beyond belief. And you now officially are an Israeli Navy SEAL. So now all of a sudden, if he wears his hat long enough, he may not want wonton soup or egg drop soup, he want my matzo ball soup instead. All right. Does everybody understand?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
All right.
大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大丈夫。大
Chinese or American or Italians or Germans, the fact that any government would shoot their own people in their square shows what we're all here for, is for freedom. And I respect, you know, I think there's a lot of similarities. I was making a joke about Facebook. How many people saw the movie The Social Network about Facebook? You need to see with Mark Zuckerberg, because you know Mark Zuckerberg, a Jewish guy, is married to a Chinese girl. And in the movie, he says, what is it with Jewish guys and Chinese women? Why are we always winding up together, you know? It's a funny scene. I won't say the rest. I want to ruin it for you. Go see the movie. But because I think there's a similarity is that we both, although are all here very proud to be American, we're also proud of our culture and our heritage. And we also feel a responsibility to our families in Taiwan, our families in Israel, our families in Russia, in other countries where our people came from, because we realize that we want to share the same freedom and the same opportunity that we've had to our families overseas. And we don't want to see injustice happen anywhere. So there is a commonality here. It goes beyond just, you know, watching soap operas on TV, and unfortunately now I think the attention span of an average American is a tweet. I remember, you know, it used to be 30 seconds in a commercial, now it's a 2-second tweet. The fact that we do have values and we do have things that we believe in and we respect our culture, and I think that's part of the American fabric. So again, John, thank you very much for giving the opportunity. All right, with that, thank you, John. And also, Professor Chang and Mr. Chang, I appreciate you as well, by the way. Although I didn't get it word for word, I could tell by the charts and the graphs, you were very detailed. So what I'm going to do is give you the backstory to Professor Chang's presentation. Why am I here? How did this happen? Where did this all start? And one of the things I want to mention before my presentation is, I think the real war against America is not between the Chinese and the American people. It's between the governments or the individuals occupying the governments in China and our society, which doesn't promote freedom. And I understand one of the main things that you are advocating here is to have that freedom, have that openness in China and in Taiwan, where things are fully disclosed and people do have the opportunity to speak their minds. So how did this start? That was my facility. We started in a garage in Palo Alto and then moved ultimately to Florida because we had a couple of big contracts with Disney and Universal and what have you. That was our facility that we grew into in Orlando, Florida, by the way. Just this one. Right, thank you. A point there? See, but even with an engineering degree at Stanford, I can't figure out how to use this thing. I asked my son or my daughter to get on the computer for me to do email and stuff. All right. This is an overview of the case we received. It was $39 million plus punitive damages, $41.2 million. Case against UC, dozens of Chinese corporations lived in five continents around the world. This was a giant octopus with tentacles everywhere. And it took us literally 2.5 years and over $1.5 million in legal fees to get to this point where we got this decision. But basically, the $42 million judgment, we only collected about $3 million, mainly in seizures of property in their facilities. It was only a drop in the bucket. We didn't collect more than a fraction of that. It was largely, as we say, a Pyrrhic victory, which means, you know, we got the judgment, but we didn't collect on it. They wired about $28 million out of the United States within weeks of the judgment, again, in violation of the law. And guess where the money went? Mega Bank. Okay? And then Mega Bank claims in many cases, both in Panama, we got a Supreme Court order in Panama against Mega Bank to turn over their bank records. Out of 30 banks that we served the order, Mega Bank was the only one that didn't comply. Every other bank complied and turned over their records, okay? We then went after them in Florida. They unfortunately lied and said, no, we don't have any information. And then ultimately we went after them in New York, in New York Supreme Court. Judge Joffrey Wright, who's a very distinguished jurist, said, absolutely they are required to turn it over. Mega Bank then appealed to the New York Supreme Court Appellate Division and lost. We wanted it. Unanimous decision, they must turn it over. And then we went to the New York State Court of Appeals, the highest court in New York, and they unanimously approved the decision. And to this day, Mega Bank is still not complying with the court order. So my answer, part of the answer to the question that Professor Chen said, why are they paying a $180 million fine? Why, if they didn't money launder, why didn't they just fight it, hire lawyers. And by the way, that $180 million is not their money. It's the money of the Taiwanese people, pension funds, investors, shareholders. Who are they protecting? And after losing in three major cases, they still are violating laws. The question is, who are they protecting? And I'll tell you something, I was never this famous in Taiwan until this case happened. I had no idea. But obviously, there has to be a reason. I think Professor Chen outlined the technical very, very well, technical data. The question still remains, why would they pay a $180 million fine and not fight it? And why are they still refusing to turn over documents and records? Who and how powerful an individual or a group of individuals are they protecting that they are willing to pay this money and literally violate court orders? That question remains to be answered. So anyway, the backstory of how we got to this point, I'll just give you a brief overview. I wrote the book, The Real War Against America, after the case was over, mainly because I wasn't sleeping very well even after we won, because we just could never collect, and they were playing like those, that shell game. Every time we would serve an order on one corporation, they would fold it, bankrupt it, move the money to another corporation, so you have to find another corporation, another suit to file. It was very frustrating. I felt that we won the case, but we didn't get justice. So I wrote the book, The Real War Against America, which, by the way, we have negotiated movie rights with a guy named Jeff Apple, who did In the Line of Fire with Clint Eastwood and The Recruit with Al Pacino. Don't know when or ever it's going to get made, but we'll see. Only one out of ten actually do. And like most books, you know, you have the main characters. It's myself with our first two employees, John Gonzalez and Roy Archer, where we built the whole business literally from the ground up together. And then, of course, your other main characters, which you'll learn more about. That's John Fisher, this, as he would say, very handsome, dapper man. He's very proud of himself. He's always with an unlit cigar. He's a Yale Law School graduate, graduated top in his class, who once told me, "I'm not only the smartest lawyer you've met, I'm the smartest lawyer you'll ever meet." So he was very proud of himself. And that was a first-year law student, Joe Tamborello. First year at a University of Florida Law School, goes to work on what not only becomes his firm's biggest case, but the biggest jury verdict ever issued of his firm in any case and in the state of Florida for intellectual property law. So talk about jumping out of the frying pan into the fire. We nicknamed him Austin Powers. You know the movie Austin Powers? And he goes, "Yeah, baby," you know, all that. Because he always would recite things from the movie. He had a second marriage with a young son who was 6 years old, would love to go to the Austin Power movie, so we nicknamed him Austin Powers. And this guy here we nicknamed the human computer because he had this ability to memorize case law, like chapter and verse, page number. We didn't know where he had this ability from. We later found out that on the weekends, his real passion was in the theater. He would read scripts, and because he told me it was easy to memorize case law because he would memorize scripts. So that was his talent. So, right. We're going to point back, huh? All right, here we go. All right, so, like the movie Austin Power, we gave names to all the bad guys. We named them after villains in the movie Austin Power. So, Samson Wu was... That bastard. You remember that guy? One of the villains. And Samson was pretty much as wide as he was tall, so he fit the bill. That's Samson after we got a what is called a right of replevin to break into his facility in Miami at a bonded customs warehouse, and the police made him open his vault. We searched in there. We found not only blueprints and documentation to our proprietary machinery, but also we found components that were actually stolen from our laboratory that was in Samson's facility, that some of which he already had exported to Shanghai, to his factory there, to actually duplicate our process by using our own equipment against us and our own blueprints. And then his brother, Mini-Me. Why? Because Thomas Wu was about half as wide as Samson Wu, so we called him Mini-Me. I mean, again, you're in depositions and interrogatories where the two guys are saying, answer to every question, I exercise my right under the Fifth Amendment of the Constitution of the United States. It would not answer any questions in depositions, interrogatories. Even at trial, it was getting boring, so you had to say something funny to keep, you know, let the time pass. And that's, by the way, when the FBI raided their booth at the Orange County Convention Center in Orange County, Florida. So you imagine the audacity of these criminals. They not only stole all our technology, but they actually attended a trade show in our own hometown of Orlando, Florida, showing our stolen products and selling them. Fortunately, the FBI came and shut them down. And you know, but anyway, that's an actual picture of them standing at their booth. All right, so let's talk about the technology real briefly. And I'm a big movie fan. How many of you have seen Wall Street with Michael Douglas? Wall Street, another movie you got to see. So go home, see the Facebook, the social network, then Michael Douglas, Wall Street. That's the first Wall Street movie. One of the things Michael Douglas, who played the villain Gordon Gekko, the bad investment banker who was stealing from everybody, why did you steal the company? Because it was stealable. Why did you wreck the company? Because it was wreckable. A big point in my book is, why do technology thieves steal American ingenuity and technology? It's because they can. And the FBI will even tell you the likelihood of any intellectual property thief, whether they're from Russia, China, South America, anywhere in the world, going to jail, is about equally as likely as them being hit by lightning twice. Okay? It's just not enforced. And a lot of times they steal it over the internet, they break into, they get the files, they get the algorithms to the computer program, or they get the blueprints, and they're, you know, 5,000, 10,000 miles away, and they're outside our jurisdiction. So again, why is our technology being stolen? A lot of your kids, I know, are going to school. A few of them went to Stanford and Berkeley. They're working hard. They're developing a new technology. They're building a new company. And then overnight, somebody raids their files and steals all the things that your kids have been working on for years. And now, all of a sudden, it's being used, let's say, in another part of the world where people are being paid half the wage. They're going to be put out of business. It's only a matter of months. That's how serious this is. The United States has lost millions of jobs in manufacturing because of this. So let's talk about the technology. We started out building big toys for the big companies like Coca-Cola and AT&T. That's in Times Square. That's me with the Coke bottle before it got its haircut. We had the fiber optics in it, which gave the image with the light changing from yellow to from green to brown that the bottle was being emptied when the straw came out in Times Square. It was on Paula Abdul's rock video, and every time New Year's Eve, Dick Clark, they were showing that. That was our company when we only had about 50 people when we were starting out. That's one half of the AT&T globe in Times Square. We later then got contracts for large signage projects around the world. This one is the Pepsi-Cola globe in Caracas, Venezuela. We used 7.5 kilometers, okay, of fiber optic cable on that project. And basically what we wanted to do is move away from building big toys for the big companies and get into a more commodity business that we could produce thousands and thousands of meters or miles of a standardized product that we could sell worldwide without having to do all these custom jobs. That wouldn't have allowed us to become a big business, but building a standardized product compete with a $30 billion market, which is neon, was a great opportunity. And the big advantage of fiber optic cable is it uses 1/20th the electricity of neon. It eliminates the safety hazard. The second biggest cause of restaurant and hotel fires in the United States after the kitchen catching on fire is the neon transformer arcing. You have 30,000, in an average of 15,000 milliamp neon transformer, you can reduce that to like 12 volts with a fiber optic transformer. So it's a tremendous energy reduction, eliminate energy hazard, plus there's no electricity running through the cable, just light. We're actually shooting light through the cable. Now, you can see the airport in Moscow we did. We did the world's tallest structure, the Victoria Arts Centre Spire in Melbourne, Australia. Hard Rock Cafes and McDonald's all over the world. There's McDonald's. And then in Iceland, I'll stop here for a minute. This was our first, when we first started the company, our first international distributor of all places was one of the smallest countries in the world, in Iceland. And it was owned by a gentleman named Johannes Tryggvason. He came to us at a trade show and he says, I'm going to teach you guys how to sell worldwide. I'm going to be your biggest customer. And by the way, he was from a country that had 1/4 the population of my city of Orlando, only 250,000 people. But very interesting character, and ultimately got us to do displays all over Iceland and Reykjavik. You can see we've done a lot of hotels. That's the band shell outside of Lake Eola at Orlando, Florida. And then we developed applications for swimming pools. Now, why? obviously having a 110-volt electric bulb below the water line, when the only thing separating that electricity from your child swimming the pool is a quarter-inch piece of glass cap, is not a very safe thing. But with fiber optics, all you have is light being transmitted, no electricity below the water line. Mm. So we could actually outline the pool with side load cable, light up the entire swimming pool, even light up the waterfalls. So it was a very big application of our technology. And this is the Weston and St. John, Virgin Islands. Now, I should tell you, at that time we did that job, the average age of my company was like 25 years old. And this job was supposed to take 3 days, and somehow it took 2 weeks. I wonder why. The good news is we had two staff members that came back, decided they wanted to get married, but I guess it was a beautiful place to be, St. John, Virgin Islands. So we had a lot of technical issues on this job. I don't know why. But maybe you can see. All right. We did, in Mitsui, Greenland, and Osaka, Japan, we had our distributor, Keiji Yamada, who I should also be very proud of. He was best man at my wedding. He flew all the way out from Tokyo to Argentina to attend my wedding. I attended as well. He's a world champion surfer in Japan, the number one surfing guy in Japan. So once a year I would go out and see him. He would take us surfing in, outside of Tokyo. He got these projects such as Mitsui, Greenland, the Tokyo Dome in Tokyo, Japan, all their fiber optic cable. And then, of course, we started exporting to China in 1995. Now, one of the things we were very proud of as young Americans is that we were actually exporting products more outside the United States than what we're even selling in the U.S. That we were a net GNP creator for the United States. We were generating revenue, selling our products in Japan, in China, in Russia, in Moscow, and generating revenue and creating jobs here in the United States, which was something we were very proud of. Obviously, at our first trade show, we had a number of people from certain companies overseas that would come and look at our products a little too carefully, take photographs. We realized we were doing more than admiring our product. And then all of a sudden, we had these counterfeits come out, almost within weeks of attending that show. But they weren't very good, and we didn't understand, so we didn't really pay much attention to it. But all of a sudden, many months later, products were coming out that were very close in the quality level and the output of our product, almost like somebody gave them a blueprint to our operations. We didn't understand how that happened until we had private investigators photograph one of our engineers, Jack Caruso, with James Lee, who is Samson Wu's brother-in-law, in Shanghai while he's still employed by us, signed a confidential non-compete agreement, and claimed he was taking leave because he was getting a divorce. Instead, he was in Shanghai, China, basically selling our technology to our competitors. Our blueprints, our chemical formulations, everything, lock, stock, and barrel, was being sold to them. They promised him an FBI tape-recorded phone call where Special Agent Kevin Hogan of the Maitland office of the FBI recorded a conversation where he was offered $1.2 million to steal technology that cost us over $20 million to develop and 7 to 8 years worth of hard work. So you can imagine, overnight, your entire company can be stolen out from under you and cloned, okay, by somebody who's corrupt and willing to pay off somebody. So here you see drawings that he had faxed to a law firm in Orlando and Washington, D.C., copying piece by piece our products and our machinery and equipment. There it is. And they actually filed patents on documents that we kept trade secret for a reason, because if you publish it in your patent, guess what? It becomes a blueprint for your competitors. So piece by piece, you could see that every part of the machinery, he had made drawings. When he couldn't steal the blueprints from locked files, he'd make drawings. When he had the blueprints, he'd send it. And they filed patents on our machinery and equipment that we kept trade secret and locked up on behalf of these Chinese corporations owned by Samson Wu. And you can see almost every component. Now, here is our U.S. patent. And what we were taught in Stanford is you actually publish in a patent what is obvious to anyone who would buy your product and look at your product. So obviously, the architecture of our elliptical reflectors could be measured by anybody who had any skill in the art. But what we didn't publish in our patents, what you keep trade secret, are the processes which are not obvious by anybody who would buy your product and try to reverse engineer it or take it apart. So here you see, for example, this is my United States patent under my name, dated 1998. Here's my patent, and here is the counterfeit product being made by Samson Wu using my heat sink, identical. Every single component is an exact copy. So again, it's hard to have an even playing field between American workers here in Silicon Valley and companies in Asia that are stealing the technology and counterfeiting them when they can actually take the patent and use it as a blueprint, and then in other cases, as you saw, pay off employees or insiders to steal the rest of the information they need. Hundreds and hundreds of American companies are put out of business, and that means less opportunity for our children who live here in this country. Again, you can see more of the patents that were used. So finally, with all the evidence that we obtained, we got a U.S. Court order to get the Dade County Sheriff to go to the Marsam Trading Facilities in Miami, Florida. They had a bonded customs warehouse. I'll tell you a little bit more about that later. And we were able to break in with the two sheriff's deputies with us in replevin. That means recover our stolen information. And while we were there, we got no far as this Marsam Trading U.S. Customs bonded area, which, by the way, we later found had $3 million for a counterfeit product. But before I could even walk through that door, this voluntary bankruptcy proceeding, Chapter 11, they had very smart lawyers. You know, the problem with America is everything's free and open. So when you get a court order, the judge requires you to serve the court order on the opposing party. So they knew we were coming to raid their facility. So their smart lawyers, and they paid like $500 an hour, filed an involuntary bankruptcy procedure, which is a federal court. We were in a district court. That trumps our order. We had to go home. So I'm like peeking through the door, and I see hundreds of spools. I had no idea there were thousands, but hundreds of them. I said, wait a minute, all this is going to be destroyed. I looked in their filing cabinets, hundreds and hundreds of documents, sales invoices for selling product that they were previously lying to the judge, saying we're not in the fiber optic business, we're not selling them. All that evidence was there. I said, this is going to be destroyed. So I got furious. He says, I'm sorry that the sheriff said a federal bankruptcy court order trumps our district court replevin. We have to leave. I says, in what country do they allow a criminal to file a court order to deliberately stop you and all the evidence is going to be destroyed? He said, unfortunately, ours. We have to go. So I walked outside and I called the famous John Fisher, the smartest lawyer in the world, according to himself. I used his ego against him. I said, John, you tell me you're the smartest lawyer in the world, you get me the hell back in there. I don't care how you do it. I want another order back in there immediately. Now, you said you're a Yale Law School graduate, the smartest guy in the world. Prove it to me now. So John says, well, you know, next Thursday is Thanksgiving. And they have many corporations there located at the same address. I can go back to Judge Kirkwood and file against another corporation, and I can give him the order at 4:59 p.m. on Wednesday night. They'll never see the order till Monday, but I'll get him to sign it, and you can break in there on Thanksgiving. How would you like that? I said, it's very smart. So I asked the two sheriff's deputies if they're willing to work on Thanksgiving, and they felt bad. They said, absolutely. Here's my cell phone number as you call us. I came back there, but this time not with a locksmith, with a sledgehammer. I smashed the door myself. Most fun I ever had. And this is what it looked like when we went there. All right. Every single file was shredded.
Wow.
Literally over 800 pounds of documents, 7 dumpsters filled with shredded documents, and still shredders that were so over full, they had the bag there and you could still see it's full. They were shredding night and day for 4 days. This is destroying documents against a court order. Guys, how do you fight? I mean, it's a big question Professor Chen has said. How do you fight with a giant company who breaks all the rules while you're required to follow the rules? Who lies in court? Who says they've not even in the fiber optic business when they have thousands of documents proving otherwise, and then 4 days later you go back, they're all shredded? How do you fight against them? How do you get justice? Just so you can see, some of the documents that we actually retrieved were from the 2B shredded box, where here you see Cosmic Corporation, owned by the Wu's in Hong Kong, shipping to Marsam Trading in Florida. What? An invoice for fiber optic products that they claimed 3 years in front of 2 judges that they weren't in the business of doing. Red-handed, right there. And we can only imagine how many documents were shredded, because there were 7 of these dumpsters filled top to bottom. So what did I do? I hired Brink Security. They said, the sheriff kind of winked and nodded and says, you know, all those shredded documents, it's open season. If you wanted to take them all back and try to put them in there, you could. So I did. I retrieved them all, and then I hired some kids from my son's sports teams to go on the basketball court paste them together. They're working all day and night at like $10 an hour. They thought they were going to get rich. So, hey, you know, there were 12, you know? And they put together enough documents that we actually found where the head of the Octopus was, the corporate headquarters for Samsung Wu, which we never knew, in Shanghai, the factory that was making all our counterfeit products. And by the way, I should mention to you, during this time, I heard a PBS speech from the head of one of the big labor unions, and I was really surprised to see that they were not bashing, even though they were losing their jobs to China, they were not bashing the Chinese people. What I was very surprised to hear, the head, and I wrote about this in my book, I can't remember his name right now, it's one of the tough, bearded, you know, union leaders, in a very eloquent term said, no, we're doing this not to attack the Chinese people trying to get fair labor laws between China and the United States. We're doing this because we want all our brother workers everywhere around the world to have the same freedoms and protections that we enjoy here. Because if everybody, if you don't have people working in prison labor conditions, they have a better life, and also everyone has an opportunity to have equal level playing field worldwide. I thought that was very, very enlightening to hear a labor person, instead of fighting against people, realize that many of the people that were living under that system where they're breaking all the laws counterfeiting, they're in terrible. They have no child labor laws. They're not getting any protections. One of the things my private investigators, who I'll show you, some of their faces you'll see I had to black out because a few of them used to work for the Israeli government. Now they're private investigators in their own right. They told me the reason why, you know, they have walls there, why they have walls in a lot, most of these factories, it's not to keep the people from coming in, it's to keep the workers from running out. This is the suicide rate in some of these factories are terrible. They're getting young girls from the countryside. They're sleeping in dorms where they're stacked in bunk beds 3 or 4 high. They work them 12 hours a day. It's actually shameful how these people are being treated. And that's part of the reasons why we all need to work for justice. There's a human factor here, separate from the business and the technology factor. All right, let's go to the next slide. There we go. So we had what we referred to as the Sheikh of Dubai. It was one of our private investigators. His name I can tell you because he works, he was with the New York City Police Department. His name is Ted Kavaris. He owns Panoramic Consulting in Hong Kong. Ted actually went in dressed like a Sheikh of Dubai. He had the dastasha, the beard, the whole nine yards. And it was amazing. I was listening to him selling them on deals, capturing on videotape when they were telling the judge they weren't in the business, selling fiber optic product on video, but I'm hearing him speaking Arabic like with a Brooklyn accent. Yeah, assalamu alaikum, alaikum salam. I mean, amazing. He could have been a Martian. It wouldn't matter. As long as he was paying him cash, they were very happy. And Samson Wu's brother signing and chopping a contract for fiber optic cable, to be sure. He made sure he signed it. He got a copy of his passport and his driver's license. And here they are, more than a year and a half after they were served with a court order to cease and desist, to freeze all assets. They're violating the court order in China, selling our fiber optic cable to a client on video. And if you want to realize why our judgment was so high, is we had proof that they were stealing and counterfeiting our product and also violating the judge's orders and going to the judge in line and saying that they were not violating the orders. This is our optical bench, or by the way, a very crude reassembly of our optical bench. Jack Caruso had stolen from our laboratory, piece by piece, an optical bench that we used to align our light sources in an elliptical reflector, which was one of the key to the brightness of our cable, which is what made it competitive in the neon industry. Reassembled right there in a facility in China. Can you imagine our own equipment being used against us overseas? So we had a big problem. I was told now, after over $1.5 million of legal fees, and almost 2.5 years, our trial is a couple weeks away, and guess what? Samson Wu and his team won't have to go to trial, and they won't be liable for the judgment. And I said, are you kidding? What happened? He says, unless we serve them with the suit, they're not required to show up, and they're not, if they don't show up and appear, they're not required to be liable for the judgment. Through the Hague Convention, we're supposed to serve them with the summons in any other country outside the United States through our embassy. Well, of course, like most government agencies, which are terribly inefficient, the U.S. government employees from the embassy went, knocked on the doors of the known residences and offices of Samson Wu. Hello, any Wu here? And they go, nope, no Wu here. And they would go home and have a pizza. But we got the judge to give us a special dispensation to let our private investigator go there and serve him. What do you know? Private industry. The first day, there we are serving Thomas Wu. We got video of it to make sure he couldn't claim he wasn't served. And then Mr. Kavaris got very creative. Instead of being a Saudi sheikh, he dressed up as a Domino's pizza delivery. For Pizza Hut, and instead of pizzas, they got summons! Hooray! So, very creative guy. All right, I don't know why this is not liking you. There you go. All right, so we finally got back into their facility. The judge had enough. We got the order, and here is some of the pallet loads of fiber optic cable from that warehouse that I was forced not to enter when their lawyers played that little dirty trick. And obviously, we could not sell this fiber optic cable to our clients, so what we did is donated it to Give Kids the World, which is a children's village in Kissimmee, Florida, of terminally ill children who have cancer, leukemia. They're brought by the Make-A-Wish Foundation to go out there and spend a week with their families. So it's the most well-lit up facility in the world. We're very proud at least that went to a good cause. What infuriated me and what should infuriate all of you as American taxpayers is after the judge got so infuriated that they were lying in court, he instigated a separate action called fraud on the court. And Samson by then had wired all his money out of the country and we couldn't prove where the assets were or if he had any. He actually filed for indigency and got your tax money to pay for his lawyer on the fraud of the court. He had a hired lawyer by the court that was being paid by all of us. I don't know what pissed me off more, watching him hide behind the Fifth Amendment of the Constitution of the United States, or later claiming indigency and having hundreds of thousands of dollars in legal fees paid by all of us to defend him. But, you know, amazing. What a great country we live in, right?
Are they Chinese or Taiwanese?
He's Taiwanese originally, but he has both a Taiwanese, a Chinese, and a Panamanian passport, and a U.S. passport.
No, yeah. Originally he is a Taiwanese.
Taiwanese.
Not Chinese.
Yes, that is correct.
So Taiwanese is his mother language. Is that what he's got?
Correct, correct. But he has operations in Hong Kong and Shanghai. And most of his operations are in mainland China. I know that his brother has a house in Taiwan, in Taipei, because we did some research. But now Samson's living in Panama full time. That's where he's operating. So, yeah. So just so you see, this is his house in Panama. He has a $250,000 condominium at Coco Bay while he was receiving subsidies and funds to pay his lawyer in the United States. I'll show you, we also show you pictures of his, he owns two city blocks in through Stephanie S.A. and Stacy S.A. This is like equivalent of Times Square in Panama. Very expensive real estate, but he holds it through third-party corporations that's in the names of his daughters, Stephanie and Stacy. Just $150,000 worth of watches, just in one window of his retail stores that we trace back to him. And meanwhile, you and I are paying out of our tax money to his lawyers because he claimed he was indigent. It's amazing how they can abuse the system. And here's some warehouses that they own in Panama, our private investigators have photographed. So anyway, the theft of U.S. technology is actually costing the American government more than a war on terrorism. A Business Week article claims that the theft, and this is back in 2005, is $750 billion in terms of lost jobs and technology. Probably by now it's over $1 trillion. So you can imagine with a $20 trillion deficit, if we were able to enforce the patent laws, where a Microsoft executive came to me when I was speaking at the National Classification Management Conference in Connecticut, was at the one of the major Indian casinos. They had a huge conference on that. Now, we were approached by actually two Microsoft lawyers. They said, you know who's the biggest manufacturer of Microsoft software in the world? Any guesses? China. For every one legitimate copy being sold by Microsoft, three is done by counterfeiters overseas. Can you imagine what it would mean to the United States if that revenue was being reported here, those salaries were being paid to our citizens here in California and Washington and elsewhere where all the Microsoft facilities are located? We could probably pay off the national debt in less than 5 years if we would just be able to stop or enforce our laws. So this was of an overview. I'm not big on political correctness, by the way. That's after 4 years at Stanford, this is my favorite equation.
Okay? This is
yes. All right, what we must do, and you know, I don't like it when people come up and just talk about a problem and then don't offer any solutions. Because, look, you know, we're all worried about the futures of our kids, our grandchildren. You know, whether we know it or not, we're approaching Greece or maybe surpassing Greece in terms of debt per capita. We know what trouble Greece is in. We don't want that to happen here. Here are some solutions. We can enforce our laws to protect manufacturers, deny World Trade Organization membership and most favored nations trading status to nations who are violating our laws. Why are we allowing them to benefit being a member of the WTO when they're breaking every single law? Punish offending nations with high tariff or punitive embargoes. Now, a lot of people think that's crazy coming from a guy whose first book, The Introduction, was written by Professor Milton Friedman, who was at the Hoover Institution of Law at Stanford, and he's the biggest free trader in the world. But even I think Milton Friedman will tell you there's a difference between free trade and fair trade, and just like if you speed on our roadways, you get a traffic ticket, well, a punitive tariff is the equivalent of a traffic ticket to nations that are breaking our free trade laws. So there has to be some sort of deterrence in order to stop the behavior. And last, restructure the U.S. tax code to encourage savings and investment automation. I don't know about you, but I think this April 15th thing is the biggest stupidity that we have to deal with every year, counting every receipt, doing all this. We should have a slow, flat tax on consumption, do not punish people for income, and just basically have a flat consumption tax. Can you imagine the millions and millions of hours and billions and billions of dollars that everybody involved in tax preparation and tax accounting, if they didn't have to deal with an April 15th deadline every year? Businesses, individuals, they just pay as you go. We really need to get rid of that because, again, I'm not necessarily against the IRS. I was audited several times, and the IRS was very fair to me. I just don't think that process makes any sense. We're consuming too much of our time and energy paying lawyers and accountants to read a 60,000-page tax code about when we can go to a simple flat tax. The other thing is the U.S. can compete. We're never going to compete with cheap labor. You're not sending your kids to college to make $5 or $10 or $15 an hour on a production line. You're sending your kids to college so they can innovate and develop technology. One of the great breakthroughs, I think, that's going to change the entire equation where cheap labor is not going to really matter anymore is nanotechnology. When we start building and designing on the molecular level, it's going to be skilled workers and machines, not cheap labor by hand, that's going to rule the world. U.S. needs to focus on that. That's where we're going. That's where we can maintain our lifestyle and move forward with our standard of living by getting involved in manufacturing. We use nanotechnology, robotic automation. We've used pick-and-place robotics to make our PC boards. That's where I think the future are, and we should encourage that, both in our schools as well as in our tax code. So with that, I've given you an overview of where we were, why did we get to this point, what led us to the fact that a small company in Orlando, Florida would wind up picking a fight with the largest bank in Asia and winding up on Professor Peng's show in Taiwan. I mean, when I think about this is almost insane. You know, I mean, I was talking to John and Mr. Chen in the car, you know, that we all came here as through some strange twist of destiny. If you asked me about this 20 years ago, I would say, no way. You know, it wouldn't be in my wildest dreams. But we're all here for the main reason. We believe in freedom. We believe in justice. We want a good life for our family. And we do care about our relatives and where we came from, just like I do in Israel and you do in Taiwan. And with that, you have my great respect. And if there's any way I can help support your cause as well, I'd be honored to do so. So thank you very much for having me.
It's a really wonderful thing. I think breakfast would like to take a few moments and to answer the question if you want to.
Absolutely.
Brett, do you try hire a lawyer over
over in Shanghai to file a lawsuit against that, the Wu's family for the privacy of a pirate of intellectual property from this country. And you might try to do it to set a case for the future under this Trump administration due to like unfair trade between the United States and the man in China. I think that's a good case. If you try to fight for it, even if you cannot win, but you can build a case for the unfair, the private pirate of the intellectual property. For that, that's number one. Number two, you know, to develop a business that research and development, R&D, acquisition, and steal, which is Samsung Wu's family doing right. That. What if they want to make an offer to acquire your company? How much you will ask?
Let me do the second question first. Our company was ultimately acquired, two different companies, and ultimately is now part of Revolution Lighting Technologies, RVLT, which is owned by a billionaire named Robert LaPenta, who founded L1, L2, and L3. L3, as you know, is about a $20 billion company traded on the New York Stock Exchange. He basically now is going about acquiring LED lighting companies and high-tech lighting companies the same way he went around and buying up and merged defense contractors. And L3 is one of the biggest defense contractors in the world. And I think he's got ideas to make what used to be Supervision and the other companies related to us a multi-billion dollar LED lighting company. So I don't think it's for sale. and Robert LaPenta has 100 times more money than Samson Wu, so I don't think Samson... Oh, thank you. Appreciate it. I don't think Samson could write that check. Now, getting back to your first question. Yes, we hired Lovell's Law Firm in Hong Kong. They're a British firm based in Hong Kong that litigates cases. Basically, they told me, filing a case in China back then, this was 12, 14 years ago, you have as much chance of winning in China as you do with a snowball flying through hell without melting. So as a result, we did as you said, and you're right, this is something that should be considered, but it's not likely. Now interestingly, I've heard recently China has ruled in favor of Donald Trump with his trademark. And apparently, China is starting to try to give the appearance that they have jurisprudence on a world level there as well. And they have been finding in favor of American companies. So maybe that's changing now. Right now, though, I can't get Megabank to answer an American court order. I can't get them to answer a court order in New York that's been approved by two appellate courts. I can't get them to answer a court order in Florida or California. When they get punched in the nose, they don't like that so much. So I have a feeling that what you say is ultimately going to happen if they don't turn over the records. Because how does $3 billion go missing where neither there's a record of the wirer or the recipient? That doesn't happen in any bank. And Mega Bank is not a third world bank in the middle of Uruguay or someplace or some banana republic. It is a major bank in a major country. Let's face it, Taiwan is a serious industrial nation. We can have debates about the leadership, but it is a serious industrial country. You don't just, if Chase Manhattan Bank, JP Morgan Chase, would wire $3 million and not have records of the recipients, do you not think some of those guys would go to jail? So I think ultimately that very much could happen, and God willing, they'll either do one or two things, either turn it over or they're going to see some people stand trial in criminal court in the United States. Very good point. Thank you, sir.
When this statement comes out, did they have to turn up a name with them?
Professor Chen?
6 months. So
6 months from when?
From the day
of the order. And what was the date of the order?
August.
February. If they confuse to turn over information this long,
and we're willing to pay $180 million. I'm very curious what information, if any, they're going to turn over. And how do we know it's even legitimate? The person turning over the information can turn over what they want.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But do you have any ideas about those?
All right, guys, I've had a lot of strange phone calls from people in mainland China and Taiwan in the past couple of weeks. And in fairness to the people who've reached out to me, I'm not going to name names, but I've heard a lot of theories and a lot of conspiracy theories about everything from family of government officials to mentioned on Dennis's program, the Yamagamaguchi, the Kuomintang, and what have you. I don't know. The answer is I don't know. But I can tell you, it's not more than common sense to realize that somebody doesn't pay an $180 million fine and violates at least three New York State and a federal judge's order and refuses to turn over in the United States and a Panamanian Supreme Court order that we achieved in Panama and served on them, they refuse to respond unless they're protecting somebody very important.
So we don't know.
We don't know. Please.
There's several things here. One is the intellectual property. That's one issue. The other is that if you are trying to bring Sanfeng to justice, it, that may lead to eventually this money laundering issue now more and more be exposed. But my question is that who is this Sanfeng? Why make a bank trying to protect him? We understand that now these money laundering and all that, they have the big guy.
You sound just like Professor Dennis Penn. He says the same thing as you.
Oh, really? He was my classmate.
Yeah,
by the
yeah, classmate. Okay.
I didn't watch his program, but he was my classmate.
He's a great guy.
Yes.
I like him very much.
Yes.
And I like that Mrs. Chow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, Coco. Coco. She's a fire. I wrote. I sent her a book. I said, Coco. You are a tiger. You sound just like me. I think the answer is, who is Sam Tuwu? He's a pawn. He's someone they use like Angel Caballero, who's the branch manager who they're claiming never was a branch manager. That's interesting. We'll find out. They're using people as fronts to move money on behalf of people whose names do not want to surface, whose identities do not want to disclose. So how do you launder money? The very definition is you use other people's names and other people's accounts to move money for people who are not named to places, other places which you do not want to identify. That's where phony corporations are set up. In New York, we used to have a lot of restaurants that nobody ever showed up to eat, but they were doing millions of dollars worth of business. And you can just guess who was running their money through these restaurants. They were laundering the money. They were taking the money from illicit activities and moving it through legitimate companies and making it look like revenue. They'd even pay taxes on it. They put it in banks. But you just can't show up at J.P. Morgan Chase in New York and give them $20 million in cash and not have an excuse where you got the money. Under our banking laws, you can't do that. So I think these guys are just people who are used by much bigger people to hide money that they were getting illicitly.
Yeah.
And one of the guys who called me, you know him, I don't want to mention his name because he was formerly with the Taiwan Secret Service and he was also a personal bodyguard to the former president of Taiwan, said that a few million of it went to an American president to help him with litigation fees with one of his personal cases. And he then later ruled the way the Taiwanese government wants. This all will come out eventually because the FBI is already looking into this. But I got to tell you something. This is all interconnected, okay? And I'm not a big believer in conspiracy theories, but after seeing this, I'm with you. Right.
They might as well give you $40 million and that's it, right?
I'm gonna hire you as my lawyer. Because I think that when you're dealing with at least $3 billion, what we know of, okay?
That is today.
$180 million is less than 7% of $3 billion. So to them, it's chump change. Later on, I think when this gentleman's question that I spoke with earlier about shutting down banks, mm-hmm. you shut down the branches in New York, Chicago, Los Angeles. You're talking about tens of billions of dollars of capital investment being shut down. That's when all of a sudden it's no longer a parking ticket. That's when it hurts. And your question was very much on point. Yeah. I'm sorry, there was another question. Yes, ma'am.
Will you consider for the president election in 2020?
You must not like
me. We will support
you. I like you very much, but you must not like me. That's a very dirty business. You think this business is dirty dealing with the banks? My God, run for president.
Because it will reach your goal eventually. You know, much easier and make the country much clean, and you know the tax code will be changed, and the financial business will be much clean, based on your belief. So we will support you if you do.
If I do this, I'm going to hire you as my press secretary. Thank you. Yes, sir.
You talked about today advancing trading with foreign countries. It should be more positive American goods, right? Mm-hmm. Going forward.
Yeah.
If you think it will make a difference, this administration. Also, you say you collect 1.4 million so far.
Right. And they just paid my legal fees.
You need
that's
to
all.
Collect more, right?
Yeah.
So, what would you say this 3-5 years from now? Would you bring back a lot of money back to you?
Well, to answer your first question, I really still believe, in spite of all this, in free trade. Mm-hmm. But in order to have free trade, you have to have fair trade.
Fair trade, yes.
Okay? I have no doubt that the people sitting in this room, you built your sportswear business, you did it yourself, started from nothing, built a successful sportswear business, okay? You didn't need to be protected, you competed, and you competed successfully. If somebody, though, would come into your factories and steal your machinery and counterfeit it and steal your designs and steal your customer list, now it's not competition. It's thievery, okay? So I would never get to the point would say we would not have free trade, because I think free trade, if the rules are equally applied, is good for all the competitors worldwide. And I have no doubt that your kids and my kids, after they get out of college, will be very successful in competing with anyone in the world. We have that intellectual base, okay, here. We have great education, we got great schools. What I would do is enforce our trade laws aggressively. And I believe it's open season on American companies because our idiots in Congress have allowed it to be. They have not enforced the law. And I'll tell you one of the reasons. To a certain extent, because of the incompetence in our administration, and I don't think it's fair to blame China for our problems, because most of our problems was created by our own stupidity in our Congress. Okay? We have a $20 trillion deficit. Look, the leaders of the People's Republic of China didn't come to the United States and hold a gun to our head and said, you've got to get $20 trillion in debt. We did this. Are the idiots in Congress. So I have to tell you, and I mean really, most of the people in Congress, if you look it up, couldn't qualify for an American Express card because they've had such irresponsible personal financial management. They went bankrupt once or twice, and now they're running the biggest budget in the world. Isn't it crazy? You know, this is the only job you can run for without any qualifications or requirements. Could they allow a doctor to do open heart surgery on you without a medical degree? So that let these guys go into Congress with nothing but, excuse me, bullshit stories, you know? That was their only qualification. So all I'm saying to you is I would definitely enforce the laws, and I would definitely require maybe make some changes to make sure that we are enforcing laws. Because one thing to have a law, it's another thing to enforce it, okay? Make sure the playing field's equal. I also would tell you that we need to focus in nanotechnology. I was just at a conference with the Israeli Navy SEALs and the U.S. SEALs where some of the SEALs who had already got out of the business had started high-tech companies in Silicon Valley. One of which I told you is a GPS company. It was a Jewish guy from New York who went to Israel to volunteer for the Navy SEALs, came back, and he developing a GPS company where he can change the accuracy of GPSs from 3 feet to 4 inches. It's company's got close to, I don't know, half a billion or $1 billion valuation now. No revenue. I mean, God bless America, they only happen here. But to me, an average person would say, well, what does it matter? You know, such a valuation going from 3 feet to 4 inches. When we talk about driverless vehicles, 3 feet in a traffic lane is not going to keep you from getting into an accident. 4 inches is keeping you in your lane will. So there, it's a huge breakthrough. That's what happens in this country. But again, if his technology, his algorithms were stolen and given to countries that are maybe authoritarian, not friendly to us, now your children or my children who might have worked for a company like that and got a great salary don't have that opportunity, that's a problem. So I believe in free trade, but I believe in fair trade. In terms of the collection, look, what did drive me 14 years chasing Megabank? I spent $1 million of my own money, maybe more, chasing them. Was it money? No. I was just one angry dude who just had enough, okay? and I remember when I was growing up, I didn't have resources. You know, my mother was a nurse who raised 3 boys after my dad passed away in a one-bedroom apartment in New York. I mean, we didn't have the resources to fight Megabank or what have you, but, and I remember how it felt when you were someone who didn't have the power, didn't have the resources to fight the injustice. So after I sold my company, built a real estate company, and had the resources to do it, you're damn right I went after them. And I went after them. They're probably thinking, just like I'm thinking they're crazy not to turn over the documents, they're probably thinking, this guy's crazy, he'll just never go away. He's like, he'll come after me, you know? Well, you're right, for the record, into the camera, Megabank guys, I am crazy, I'm coming after you, and you're never going to get rid of me until I bring you the documents.